Hello there, I'm Lucy Hockings. From the BBC World Service, this is The Global Story. Today, would you eat meat that has been grown in a lab? What if it could help protect the planet? The UN estimates that emissions from livestock make up more than 14% of all man-made greenhouse gases, including methane. Lab-grown or cultivated meat is often touted as the solution to climate-friendly meat production that tastes exactly like the real thing. But it's only been approved for human consumption in the US and Singapore. Italy and the states of Alabama and Florida have all decided to ban lab-grown meat this year, despite not yet being available to buy. So why are some places trying to ban lab-grown meat before it's even hit the shelves? With me today in our London studio is Graihagh Jackson, host of the Climate Question programme on the BBC World Service. Hi, Graihagh.
Hi, Lucy.
And joining us from our Singapore bureau is Asia business reporter Nick Marsh. Hi, Nick.
Hi, Lucy. Hi, Graihagh.
Nick, you know exactly why you're here. You're not only in Singapore, which has the distinction of being the first country in the world to approve lab-grown meat, but, and this is the big thing, Nick, you are part of a very special club. You are one of very few people who has actually tried lab-grown meat.
Yeah, I have that dubious honour, Lucy. Obviously, I'm based here in Singapore. I'm a reporter here. And one of the things that people seem to be really, really interested in is the fact that Singapore is one of the only places in the world, the first place in the world, actually, where you could eat lab-grown meat. And back in 2021, there was this restaurant that was selling these sort of chicken nugget type things by a company called Good Meat. So I got asked to go down, try it, report back. And then last year, a butcher's started selling it as well. There was a bit of a sort of a renewed PR push from the company, I think, to try and get consumers interested. So, you know, I did the same thing, did the honourable thing, sacrificed myself
for
journalism.
You took one for the team,
had a bit
Nick.
Of lunch. Took one for the team, exactly.
What about you, Graihagh? Would you try it?
As a journalist, I feel like I ought to, and as a climate journalist, especially given the impact that meat has on our climate. But on a personal level, you know, I'm not a big meat eater. I'm mostly vegetarian, so it isn't that appealing for me to try on a personal level.
Yeah, I found it quite challenging too. I mean, my dad was a farmer, so growing up, we just ate organic beef from cows that have been raised on the farm. So it's quite a leap for me to go from that experience as a child to eating lab-grown meat. But as a family in London, we eat a lot of meat and we are trying to cut down, not just for our health, but for the environment as well. So I think I also would probably be tempted to try it for journalistic reasons as well. But can you tell us, though, what are we actually talking about, Graihagh? What is lab-grown meat?
Essentially, what they're trying to do is replicate the process in a cow, outside a cow. And they're doing that in a lab. And that means you don't have to slaughter an animal. So in theory, it's more ethical. And how they do that is they take a small biopsy, perhaps the size of a pea or a peppercorn. They take it back to the lab. They put it in something called a growth medium or a growth media. That's essentially a broth with lots of nutrients in that means the cells can grow. You keep it at body temperature and it does indeed grow from something the size of a pea to a beef burger or in Nick's case, chicken nugget sized.
The key thing is the texture and the taste. And Nick, you've already made it quite clear what a dedicated journalist you are, going out there and trying it for yourself. And of course, you recorded yourself doing it.
Here you go.
Naturally, I had to try some too, of course. All right, so moment of truth. Smells like fried chicken. Yeah, tastes like fried chicken. Bit processed maybe, but no, you would never know where this came from.
Tell us the truth, Nick. Did you like it? Did you enjoy it?
Firstly, I just want to say sorry because there's nothing worse than listening to someone eat or watching someone eat if you're watching the podcast. No, I did like it, Lucy. I did, actually. I didn't know what to expect. But the main thing I would say is that I would have had no idea where it came from. You know, it tasted just like a chicken nugget. So the texture was the same. The taste was the same. It tasted like a bit of processed meat. It wasn't a plant-based sort of alternative that you've probably tried where there's always something a little bit off. It was legit. I've got to say it was legit.
I mean, one of the very best things about Singapore is the food. It's absolutely wonderful. You can get cheap, great food out all the time. What about the other people in the restaurant? What did they think, Nick?
The people in the restaurant were there because they wanted to try it. So they had a curious, open mind anyway. The reaction I got was pretty much the same as my own.
It's meat. It's perfect.
I think if you went out into the street or you went down to a hawker centre, something like that, and you started telling people about meat grown in a lab, I don't think you'd have got the same kind of reaction. People like their fresh produce here, so it'd take a lot of convincing to actually get people into that idea.
Why have they chosen to be one of the very first countries in the world where you can process and eat lab-grown meat?
Well, the Singapore government, they're always, you know, open to experimentation, to innovation. Frankly, they have the money to do that kind of thing. I mean, it's a small country, but they're always looking for what's going to kind of give them the edge, technology-wise. But also, Singapore's a country, a government at least, that's obsessed with food security. You know, this is a tiny little dot on the tip of Malaysia. 90% of everything that people eat and drink here is imported. And when COVID came around, that was a bit of a wake-up call. So the Singapore government started to look for alternatives. They give a lot of grants, tax incentives to companies that grow their own food here, things like vegetables. So, you know, lab-grown meat is just a step in that direction of increasing self-sufficiency one day.
What about in the rest of the world, though, Nick? As you've mentioned, Singapore, just a dot. Is it taking off elsewhere?
The United States last year became the second country to authorise it. In terms of how widespread it is, in terms of how available it is to consumers, we're talking tiny, tiny numbers. I think there was a couple of restaurants in the States, in Washington and in San Francisco, that were offering this type of lab-grown meat. It's not something you're going to find on the shelves.
Nick was talking there about food security, but a lot of people in the world who are concerned about the environment are also concerned about the impact that eating meat is having, because animal agriculture is responsible for more gas emissions that damage the environment than flying. And I know in New Zealand, half of the emissions in New Zealand are from agriculture. So a lot of people are reconsidering what's on their plate in the evening or what they're eating during the day because of their concerns about the environment. Is lab-grown meat a potential solution to this?
I think it depends who you ask. I think people working in the industry would absolutely say yes. You know, the people that I spoke to in the past all come from it from an environmental background. You know, they're vegetarians, they saw a problem, they see that meat consumption is not only stabilizing or going down, but it's actually going up. And they think, here's a problem that needs a solution. So I don't doubt their intentions and their ambition there. But again, because there is a lack of transparency in the industry, there's not very much around in terms of data. So you see these big claims, whether that be, you know, 39% less energy and 87% less greenhouse gases, but they're very hard to verify. I did speak to one person, John Lynch. He's a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Oxford, and he did advise some caution around these numbers. The other thing I spoke to John Lynch about were some of the concerns he had about cultivated meat in terms of the climate context. And he did have quite a lot of them. But the key one for me was around carbon dioxide, this key planet warming gas that we all worry about. And the reason why that seems to be such an issue with cultivated meat is because it's very energy intensive to produce as it stands, as is the growth media, this broth that it grows in, right? Now, you may think, well, is that so much of a problem? Governments have got plans to pivot away from fossil fuels and move towards renewables. But actually, if you have very energy intensive industries that are taking more and more of that share of renewables, that could be really problematic.
So impossible for us to know just how green lab meat is at the moment. But how real is the issue of agriculture and climate change?
It's a really big issue and it's a really important highlight. You said at the top of the programme around 14% of emissions come from livestock. And that's really important to understand. There are lots of reasons for that. Beef in particular is a huge emitter of methane, and that's because cows, once they chew the grass, they actually burp up methane. And that's a really potent planet warming gas. There's also concerns around deforestation to graze the cattle, but also to grow the crops that they eat. And those crops are also sprayed often with nitrogen fertilizers, which lead to nitrogen oxide emissions, another potent greenhouse gas. So the issue of animal agriculture is really a big one in terms of the fight against climate change. But there are also lots of alternatives. You know, we're talking about lab-grown meat today, but there are plenty of plant proteins.
Tofu,
chickpeas, lentils, beans. These are all protein sources that come from plants, have a very low impact on the climate and are already widely available.
Where are we seeing meat consumption go up though, Graihagh?
India? India is a country, basically countries that are developing and becoming richer are more able to spend more money on meat.
Now, we've been hearing how excited some scientists are about all of the opportunity, the potential of lab-grown meat. But I know lots of people who are just passionate about their meat, protective of the industry, passionate about protecting it too. Where are we seeing that kind of opposition, Nick, to lab-grown meat?
In terms of legislation, we've already seen that in the United States. So the governor of Florida has already banned the sale of lab-grown meat, Ron DeSantis. His message was basically, we don't want this fake stuff, you know, get it out of our state. Interestingly, though, he didn't ban research towards more lab-grown meat. Apparently, the main concern was around safety.
But if you're a politician, Nick, in a state where the beef industry is big, it's worth a lot of money. So those are votes too.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, that's competition, isn't it? That's competition for a multi-billion dollar industry. If all of a sudden lab-grown meat were to take off, it did become a viable alternative to meat which had been conventionally killed, then that's obviously bad news for the industry. So, you know, it's a protectionist measure in as much as it's, you know, a measure on safety grounds.
We're seeing states like Alabama, I think, considering bringing in a ban, Arizona, Tennessee as well. Those are obviously states with big farming communities. Are there places in the US, though, that are considering using lab-grown meat?
Well, at the moment, if you're not banning it, that would imply that you're allowed to sell it. So you are considering using lab-grown meat. There's a lot of money which has gone into this industry, but there's actually not much lab-grown meat being produced for consumers to actually eat.
But what about here in Europe?
Italy has also moved to ban the sale and import of cultivated meat products for very much the similar reasons to Florida. They're basing it on tradition and agriculture. And you can sort of understand that when you think about the food products that come out of Italy, right? Like Parma ham, you know, they're wanting to protect what is seen as traditionally theirs. There does seem to be some sort of culture war going on here between, you know, the lab meat industry and also MPs, and perhaps it's a vote winner, you know?
I think both of these things go hand in hand, right? I mean, if you're protecting your farmers, that means you're also protecting tradition at the same time. You know, lab-grown meat is newfangled, you know, it's almost sci-fi level. Some people love that. Some people want to pour money into that and say, great, that's the future. I can have a beef burger and not kill a cow. But then there are some people that say, hey, but what about my father, my grandfather? What about my state where we produce the best beef in the whole country? So you're not only protecting your economy, you're protecting your culture. And you can see different legislatures going in different directions. So here in Singapore, they're all about looking at the future, looking at ways to, you know, secure their food security. But in a place like Florida or Alabama, they think, well, actually, no, we need to protect what we've already got.
But Nick, given that they're concerned about food security in Singapore and there isn't a big agricultural farming industry, why is it struggling to get off the ground in Singapore?
It's struggling to get off the ground in Singapore simply because the industry as a whole is struggling to get off the ground. I mean, when I went back in 2021, don't forget, that was the first time I tried these, you know, chicken nuggets, these lab-grown chicken nuggets. I went there, I reported back. I was really, really impressed, I have to say, because I didn't know what to expect. We're, what, 3 years on now? And the product's the same, the availability's the same. In fact, you can't even get it anymore in Singapore. You can't get it in that restaurant or the butchers where that line of products got moved to. So you're not really seeing much progress. You know, I was given a tour of the production facilities here in Singapore, which was opened by a minister, big fanfare. They said it was going to open last September. We're in July now. It still hasn't opened. They were making a couple of kilos a week of chicken. And the butchers, where it was being sold, was selling 4,000 to 5,000 kilos a week, just one butcher's. So, you know, the ambition is great and it's there. The reality is right down here. And it is really all down to cost. It's too expensive.
Yeah, we haven't talked about cost yet, Graihagh, but presumably there needs to be mass production in order to drive the price down.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting because the first lab-grown burger was eaten about a decade ago on TV, you know, full of journalists. And that lab-grown burger cost over $300,000. And I think I'm right in saying, Nick, when we last spoke about this, the chicken nugget meal you had was, what, $16, $17,
yeah,
something like that.
It wasn't $300,000. BBC budget doesn't extend
no, it. But it does illustrate how much costs have come down in the last decade, right? But it is still not, it doesn't compete with conventional chicken, right?
Does it still feel, Graihagh, though, like a bit of a gimmick? Because I was kind of hoping I'd come into the studio today and on this table in front of me, there would be a whole pile of lab-grown meat for me to try and I'd have a story to tell over the weekend. It's not that easy, though, is it?
No, I mean, in the UK, there's no regulation for it, so you can't get a hold of it. And indeed, the producer of this show did try very hard for us to make that happen. You know, I mean, I get lots of press releases saying, would you like to try it first time in London? And, you know, that's, I'm coming from a place of privilege here, right? Like I have had options because I am a journalist and I work in climate. But the fact that it is available in so few places does feel a little bit gimmicky. I mean, maybe in time it won't. And I think the other thing here is about how generations' perceptions around food really, really change, right? Like, so we might feel a bit uncomfortable about eating it, but maybe the next generation won't. And that might be create a very different sort of culture around it. And maybe it won't become a gimmick anymore.
Do you think that's quite a big thing, actually, Nick? It's just for some people a bit yucky.
Yeah, I think what you just said there, Graihagh, is interesting about different generations. With that time, then, yeah, attitudes could change. You know, there are loads of things like processed food, for example, that we probably wouldn't have eaten 100 years ago. And now is, you know, part and parcel of life, isn't it?
I found that really interesting in terms of challenging my own attitude, my perceptions. I mean, in the newsroom downstairs, the big newsroom, there's a table. There is so much processed food on there, crisps, sweets, biscuits. I mean, there's no nutritional value. Goodness knows what kind of E numbers or whatever are on all of those foods. And it's laid out in the morning that people bring it in. It's gone within an hour. I mean, we eat stuff and we don't know what's in it. And yet we kind of have this weird feeling about lab processed meat.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? I mean, partly it's because it's delicious, right? So perhaps if we get to a point where lab meat is delicious, looks, tastes, has the same nutritional value as meat, maybe what's the problem? It's more ethical. Potentially it could be more green if they can get emissions under control. Why not?
I think the likelihood is that it will probably become much cheaper and it will eventually end up on supermarket shelves, but it'll just be a niche product. You know, it won't be directly competing with the big players, chicken, pork and beef, which are conventionally slaughtered. It will be something that someone who can maybe afford it, maybe is ethically minded, maybe wants to try it, will go out and buy. I think that's the likelihood, at least in the next 10 years.
Would you buy it every week, Nick?
Probably not. Probably not. But, you know, don't listen to me.
Meanwhile, Nick, you've got a very good story to tell at dinner parties, trying your lab-grown...
Yeah, I know.
Chicken nugget.
People, the reactions are interesting, actually. Some people are really grossed out by it. They hate the idea. And other people ask me, oh, where can I go and get it? I really want to try it. That sounds amazing.
I mean, that's probably, I think, reflective of what the reaction would be from a lot of people. Nick, it was great to talk to you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Graihagh.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching. And if you want more episodes of The Global Story, you can find them wherever you get your podcasts. Don't forget to subscribe to make sure you never miss an episode. We love hearing from you, so do comment on this episode as well in the section below. Thanks so much for watching. Goodbye.